watch this. We are going to actually have to get to the place to where men are able to deal with themselves. Okay? So if we are not willing and able to deal with ourselves and our emotions, then we are in trouble. I want us to understand that in order to be healed, we are going to have to deal with ourselves. Now, this is the major problem. Now, y'all forgive me, but I got to start teaching, and I don't know. I'm not seeing anything, so I'm going to put my phone down, and I'm going to flow in the spirit, and I pray to God that somebody on today is blessed. I'm at the place right now. I'm at the place right now to where I have to deal with me. All right? Can y'all still see me? All right. I have to deal with me. The problem is that no one never taught us how to take care of the root situation. No one ever taught us how to not just treat the symptoms, but get down to the root of the matter. And so we have a whole bunch of people that are not whole, that are broken, that are hurting, and have not dealt with themselves. Amen? That they have not dealt with themselves. That there's been some things that have happened to us that has caused us not to be the complete and whole man that we are supposed to be. We are half a man. Come on. And in some cases, if we're dealing with some sisters in here, we are not complete in your womanhood. All right. There has been some things that have happened. Okay. So here's the thing. So if we look at 1 Kings chapter number 19, and Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, "So let him, let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." And here's one of the most powerful things that ever happened to this man. Watch what ends up happening. And said, "And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongeth unto Judah, and left his servants there. And then he went even further to as far as he can go, and he went into a cave." God comes and see him at the cave and says, "What are you doing here?" Can I tell you something, my brothers and my sisters, that there's going to be a time in your life that things don't go your way. And what we end up doing is that we forget about the victories of yesterday. We forfeit the promises of tomorrow, and we allow fear to take over, which paralyzes us and does not give us the liberty of being whole. I'm in the wrong church. It does not give us the liberty of being whole. Yes, sir. Yes. Yes. The blue one. Okay, can you hear me now? Okay. Okay. All right. Hello? All right. I moved it up some. So now, let's get to this. Is that if we're going to be honest, and deal with this, what we're going to actually have to see is that we don't always deal with trauma correctly. Am I making sense? We don't always deal with trauma correctly. And so what ends up happening is it affects us, but then no one is able to get close enough to us so that we may be able to actually have healing. No one gets close enough to us so that we can actually have healing. If we actually look at today's text in 1 Kings chapter number 19, that Ahab talks to Jezebel. Now, I wish I had time. Now, you got to understand that the insecurities of Ahab shows the insecurities of a lot of men. That he went to his wife and his wife. Ahab had now had an experience because he was there when he saw God answer by fire. But he is still insecure in his manhood when it comes between him and his wife. So now he is challenged by the God I need to be serving because I've seen him answer by fire. But yet the punk in him tells him, baby, this will happen. She said, you know what, sucker? Let me tell you something. I got this. This is what she's saying. She is literally saying, I got this. And guess what ends up happening? She tells the prophet, the one that just was bold, the one that believed God, the one that said, yo, you know what? How long are we going to do this? Let the God that answered by fire, let's serve him. And if your God answered by fire, then I'm going to serve him. And if my God answered by fire, we're going to serve him. Okay. And we have this great challenge at Carmel. But the next day, when he hears the noise that Jezebel is out to kill him, the very next thing is he runs. And I want to ask every man in here, what are you running from? What are you running from? Come on, sisters, y'all in here too. We all need healing. What are you running from? What happened in your past that you're running from? What happened in your lifetime that you're running from? What situation? What hurt? What pain? What did the absentee of your father? What did the abuse of your mother? What did the molestation of your uncle? Come on. What did the abuse that happened inside of a church? What things happened to you that caused you to check out? It affects you, but you're running from it. And watch where you end up. You end up in a cave. So we see here that Elijah ends up in a cave and God comes and challenges him because he needs him. There's too much that you've done. There's too much you've accomplished for that one situation to cause you to quit. Watch what ends up happening. But he himself went a day's journey, verse number 4, and into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die and said, it is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. That I was not able to do what my fathers could not do. So now he begins to devalue himself. I want to show you something, that when we are attacked, one of the worst things you can do is to begin to devalue who you are. I wish I had somebody to shout, I am valuable. You might be watching me live. You might be watching me later. But I need you to say with everything that's inside of you that I am valuable. That I am valuable. That I am valuable. I was molested, but I am valuable. I was adopted, but I'm valuable. I was raped, but I'm valuable. I went through a divorce, but I'm valuable. My father left me, but I'm valuable. Come on. I wish I had somebody that really recognized that they're valuable. The first thing that you cannot afford to do is to believe that you're not valuable. You cannot forget yesterday's victory. I hope that I'm making sense on today. You cannot forget yesterday's victory. What happened in your yesterday? What happened in your yesterday? What happened in your yesterday that you're forgetting? Woo. Oh, God. What happened in your yesterday? What victory happened in your yesterday that you are forgetting? What victory in your yesterday are you forgetting? Am I by myself on today? I come to tell somebody on today that if we are not careful, what will end up happening is we will actually get to the place that we will forget how valuable we really are. How many people recognize that you are still hurt from something? that you are still in a cave. Wait a second. You got remarried, but you're in a cave. Oh, God. You're in a cave, but you're still leading worship. You're in a cave. You're in a cave, but you are still preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. You're in a cave. You're in a cave. You're isolating. You're functioning, but you're not living. See, there's a big difference when we start talking about functioning and actually living. Are you going through the motions of life, or are you at the place to where you are living? You cannot continue to be at this place, come on, to where you're not seeing the real you, not the shattered you. The enemy comes. I wish I had somebody write this down. I need you to write this down. The enemy comes to distort the view that God has of you. I need to write that down. I need to write that down. The enemy comes. The enemy comes. The enemy comes. To distort. Ooh, God, help us. Distort your image that God has of you. Oh my God. I don't know if I sent it or not. Ooh, God. So now watch what ends up happening. If there's a distortion of how you view yourself, if you don't even view yourself as valuable, if you view yourself as a victim, if you view yourself as someone that is broken and not whole, how can we get to the place of wholeness? How can we get to the place of wholeness if we are still at the place to where we believe that I'm useless, that I don't see my value, that I don't see my self-worth, that I belong on a clearance rack? Come on. The difference between high-end stuff and swap meet is that you can dicker with the salesperson on how much you're going to pay for it. Swap meet, trying to get whatever they can for it. They might know how much is valued at, but they'll accept a lesser value. I'm coming to decree and declare to somebody's life on the day that I refuse to allow you to accept a lesser value. Don't allow the enemy to dicker you down to a lower value. You are, listen, when you are in a boutique, when you're a high end, you're not just allowing yourself to go for pennies on the dollar. You know your worth. I went to a store one day and saw this suit that was on the clearance rack. And I took it up to the front desk, and I said, they said this suit was 50% off. And he rung it up, and said, he says, oh, man, he said, this is not showing. He says, are you sure you got this off of the clearance rack? I said, man, I know I got off the clearance rack. And he says, well, man, he says, wow, I can't give it to you for 50% off. This is not a sales item. I said, well, it was on the rack. He said, someone may have placed it there. Woo. I don't care where people have tried to place you. You have to know your value. And they would not give it to me for 50% off because they recognized the value of the suit. Too many times we look at ourselves as the broken situation, the heartache, the pain, instead of looking at us as being whole. So you'll never be able to walk in fullness because you're limping in your pain. I hope that I'm making sense on today. That we got to get to the place to where God is number one, and that we allow God and God alone to put the value on us. Oh, God. So now watch what happens. If we're going to be honest, you got to look at a couple of things before I get into some more detail. Number one is that he allowed what he heard. Huh? He allowed what he heard to cause fear to override his faith. He allowed what he heard to override his faith, and it caused fear. Fear paralyzed. Fear causes someone to get stuck in a place that they know they can be victorious in. Watch this. He was just victorious previous chapter on Mount Carmel. Now in this chapter, he is running and he is full of fear. You know something is wrong when, number one, he goes and leave his friend. Recognize that you are being emotional, that something is wrong, that you are not thinking properly when you begin to isolate yourself. Come on. When you begin to isolate yourself, then you are left to your own thinking. Then no one else can come and say anything to kind of pull you out of this rut that you're in, because you're at this place now that you're by yourself. And so you continue to relive the pain. You continue to relive the hurt. You continue to relive the abuse. You could come on, and ain't nobody being honest on today. Whether people want to be honest or not, men are just as emotional as women. But what we do as men, I wish I had some real men in here. What men do is that we ain't going to sit there and cry. We just go sleep with women. We ain't going to cry. We're going to go fight. Come on. We ain't going to go cry. We're going to go play ball and use that as a way that we deal with our situation. Y'all see my handle right there? What? We ain't gonna listen. And sometimes you're looking at men and you're calling them dogs, my sister. Really, they are emotionally unattached. They're emotionally unavailable. They have been hurt. And they have not dealt with the trauma of their life properly. And now what you have is a hurt boy in a man's body, because we have not dealt with what we are going through. Huh? So when you see a man, understand it doesn't go for all men, but we are who we are. Watch this, because everyone is literally the sum totals of every good and negative thing, bad and positive. Come on, bad, come on, good and positive, come on, bad and negative. We are the sum totals of everything that's happened in our life. You are who you are because of the abuse. You are who you are because of where house you was raised in. You are who you are because of the school and the environment that you were in. You are who you are because you went to this church versus that church. You are who you are because of your Weltanschauung. Your worldview is based upon everything that you have gone through. Now, if that is right, we're going to be honest and say that there are some times that we've gone through some things, that we did not recover, and we still have eternal bleeding. And too many people look at, there's cause and effect, and too many people look at the effect and not the cause. And so you want to change the person's after effect. You want them to smile again. You want them to laugh again. You want them to come out and play again. You want them to come and sing again. But really, that's not going to change the cause. We never deal with the root. And that's why some people are outwardly whole. I don't even want to use that word. Outwardly put together, but inwardly broken. Man, I got to write that down. We are outwardly put together, but we are inwardly, we are broken. Nobody wants to deal with this. Amen. Bless you, Sister Cherise. Bless you, Brother Raymond. Bless you. Here we are. If we are going to be honest, what we are actually going to do is that we're going to be at the place to where we are stuck in a cave and we got to get out. Well, how's my time? I got 18 minutes. Stuck in a cave, got to get out. Most people don't even want to deal with who they really are. Most people don't want to deal. See, men may convert one feeling into another. Men may convert stereotypical feminine feelings such as sadness or vulnerability into feelings of anger or pride. We just convert. We get sad. We don't want to say it, but men be in their feelings too. Nobody want to be honest on today. Men be in their feelings too. They're hurt. Men may shift their feelings into another area, like work, sex, getting drunk, fighting. Those are certain things that men do. But what we have to understand is that we need to be able to speak to that broken man. You know what I'm saying? Men may experience their feelings through physical complaints. That we go through something physical and we start complaining that our head hurt. Really, it's an emotional situation that is causing us to actually feel a physical pain. Nobody want to be honest. I'm telling you. But watch this. If we're going to be honest, if we're going to be honest and look at it in this light, we have to be at the place to where we be honest with ourselves, that we need God to come and help us to be whole. Now, I only have a few more minutes, and I gotta rush, okay? So y'all pray for me that I get through all this. So if we're going to be honest, what does Jesus do? What does God do? Please forgive me. What does God do? God begins to speak to Elijah, and he doesn't speak about the situation. He speaks about his need at the moment. What was the need at the moment? The need at the moment was food. So he fed him. You got to understand that out of the book of Elijah, from Chuck Swindoll's book, it talks about Elijah was not thinking realistically or clearly. When a man is in his feelings, a man is in his emotions, then what ends up happening is he's not thinking clearly or rationally. I hope this is helping someone, is that if we're going to be honest, a man is not always thinking rationally or clearly when they're in their feelings, when they're fearful, flight or fight, all the stuff that begins to go on in our mind. We don't always deal with it best. We react first and think about it later. Come on, let's be honest. Then you got to recognize that Elijah separated himself from strengthening relationships. So he goes to Judah and like, oh, that's a good place to go. Judah represents praise. So he's in a good place. He's in a place where he can go and bless the Lord at all times. And it's praise. Yeah, that's where he's going, right? No, he leaves his friends. So he's stuck by himself. And then he bypasses the place of praise. He bypasses the place of God's presence. And you know good and well, something is wrong when you bypass God's presence and go straight to your pain. You want to go to your cave. And guess why you want to go to your cave? And guess why we have done it? Because our cave feels more comfortable than dealing with it. Too many of us don't want to deal with our struggle, deal with what hurt us. I'm dealing with someone right now that's not a member of the church, but they're going through depression, and I know that they're going through, and they put up a post on Facebook, so I reached out to them just today, and I said, hey, how you feeling today? I'm not doing good. Let's talk about it. What's going on? I don't want to talk about it. I said, well, what's the trigger? I don't want to talk about the trigger. I said, okay, listen. You don't have to talk about it right now, but I want you to know that I'm here for you. I'm going to always be here for you, and I love you. The second thing I want to let you know is that you're going to have to deal with it. We're going to have to talk about these triggers if you ever want to be whole. If you ever want to be whole, if you ever want to be healed, we're going to have to talk about these triggers, these things that cause you to go back to the original pain. The trigger is not the original pain. It just brings up the pain. Man, I wish I had some more time. Oh my God, this is good. Watch this. Elijah then was caught in the backlash of a great victory. What most men have a problem with victory. Your last victory can actually cause you your next defeat. If we don't learn how to handle victory, then we actually leaves us because we become more vulnerable. Why do we become more vulnerable? We become more vulnerable because we begin to be more cavalier in our attitude. We begin to think that we did it on our own, or we can do it on our own. And no, you can't. No, you can't. I'm sorry. You can't. I'm sorry. You can't. I'm sorry. I hate to be the one to tell you. You didn't do it, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. You're going to have to humbly come before God and say, I'm broken. And God, I need thee. I wish that someone on today that watches this either now or later that will actually get to the place that they will recognize, God, I need you. Whew. Tired of being broken. When I thought about the things that have happened in my life, when I thought about the things that was real, when I thought about the times I wanted to just leave my wife, when I thought about the times I wanted to leave the church, when I thought about the times that I was tempted and tried with women, with money, with all kinds of things. Things begin to happen that make you want to go into a cave, that want you just to go into a dark place. My God, it makes you want to go in a dark place. I wish I had somebody that would be honest and say, I'm sick of darkness. Come on. I'm tired of being in a dark place. I got to get out of here. So now watch what God does. Watch what God does. Because Elijah is physically exhausted and he's emotionally spent. He's done. And then Elijah got lost in self-pity. One of the worst things that you ever can do is to be a pitiful man or a pitiful woman. Self-pity is a pathetic emotion. It will lie to you. It will exaggerate. It will drive you to tears. It will cultivate a victim mentality in your head. And in the worst case scenario, it will bring you to a point, of wishing to die, which is exactly where Elijah was, that you think that death is your only escape. And this is not the only time that you see this in the Bible. Just kill me. Let me go. That's someone that has given up on victory. That's someone that has given up on their life. That's someone that has given up on promise, destiny, goals. Come on, their future. The first thing you got to recognize is that God allowed him, my time is running out, but God allowed him to get some rest. Sometimes people got to learn this to rest. God didn't come and bring up nothing. God didn't come and say, you fool. God, and see, our problem is that we're so quick when someone is depressed, someone is dying, someone is hurting, that we're so quick to go and throw salt on the wound. I thought you was a man of God. I thought you was a woman of God. I'm hurting. I'm in a cave. You got to be careful how you deal with cave dwellers. You got to be careful with how you deal with someone that's vulnerable, someone that's on the edge. That's like walking up to somebody that is sitting there on the edge of a building about to jump from a 34-story building and say, oh, just go ahead and jump and get it over with. You got to know how to handle somebody when they are vulnerable, when they're hurting, when they're confused, when they're frustrated, when they don't even know how to interpret the F in their life. I wish I had time. When I put a post up, how do you interpret the F in your life? Does your F mean freak? Does your F mean faithful? Does your F mean failure? Does your F mean faithful? Does your F mean frustrated? Come on. What does your F mean? Does it mean fruitful? God begins to deal with Elijah after he allowed him to rest. Mm-hmm. Then God communicated with Elijah wisely. Then he came, chapter 19, verse number 9. Then he came there to the cave and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said unto him, what are you doing here, Elijah? God didn't come to Elijah and say, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. He didn't say, snap out of it. Come on. Instead, God asked a question, a simple question of clarification. I need to know what you're doing here. I need to know what you're doing here. So then God did something. God invited him to come outside of the cave so they could talk. Then God allowed fire. God allowed a whirlwind. God allowed an earthquake. And none of those times God was in those places. Elijah wanted to sit up in self-pity, but God would allow him. Do you recognize in this text, God never discusses his depression. God never discussed him being in the cave. He just asks him, why are you here? And God deals with him with kingdom value and says, I need you to go up yonder. I need you to anoint a king. And then there's this guy named Elisha that I need you to go, and he's going to be your servant. What does God do there? God gives him purpose. Do you not know that a lot of men are sitting around here feeling sorry for themselves because they feel like they don't have any purpose? Right in the church, there is men that feel like they have no purpose, no drive. There's nothing for them. This is this and this is that. What am I supposed to do? Let me tell you something, my brothers and my sisters, that God has something for you. He gives Elijah purpose. Then he gives Elijah a friend. Jesus. This is good. He gives him a friend. Elijah had to get his eyes back on purpose. He had to get his eyes back on God. So what is the thing that you need? What are some of the things that caused you to go into the cave that you haven't dealt with yet? How many people are going to be honest? Fragile. Come on. Come on, Sister Cherie. I hope I'm saying your name correctly. Sister G. What caused you to go into the cave? What chased you? What chased you? What caused you to go into the cave? What traumatic event caused you to spiral down into this depression, this dark hole, this darkened cave? And are you able to hear God like you've never heard God before? Because this time, God did not speak in the fire. He just answered by fire in the last chapter. He's worked in the whirlwind. He's worked in the earthquake. But this time, he came in a still small voice. God wants to speak to somebody to let you know that I'm calling you out of your cave. I'm calling you out of that dark place. I'm calling you out of depression. I'm calling you out of despair. Yes, I know you had failure, but I'm about to make you a faithful man. Come on, look at, oh God, I wish I had more time. Look at the disciples. When God found the disciples, they had been toiling all night. They felt like failures. They was washing their net. And God says, give me an opportunity to change the failure in your life. Drop your net on the other side. And when they did, they caught an abundance. Then he said, come. I'm going to make you fisher of men. I'm here to tell somebody on today that if you don't do anything else, recognize one thing, that you're going to have to learn to trust God. You have to give it to God. I pray right now that no matter who you are, if you're in the dark hole, the cave of your life, if you're in despair, if you're in depression, low self-esteem, hating yourself, I can't stand to even look at myself in the mirror. I don't know where you are. I hate that I had to go through this. I hate I had to go through that. Why me? Why this? Why now? I hate that I had to marry that man and he dogged me the way he did. I hate that I had to be raped. I can't outlive this. This thing is stuck with me. And I'm here to decree and declare with you that if you're going to really be healed, let me tell you something. There's nothing that has happened to you that God can't heal you from. That those scars, come on, God can heal your scars. God can heal the scars. Come on, God can heal you from the traumatic events in your life. God can do it. I believe it. I know it. I've seen it happen. God has healed me time and time again when I wanted to give up, when I wanted to give in, when I thought I was just going to cry myself to sleep every night. God stepped in and gave me joy and gave me peace. God renewed me, gave me another walk, another step, a stronger stride. God will do it. I believe it. And I'm believing for your healing right now. I'm believing for your healing. I believe in God for your healing in Jesus' name. Father, touch, heal, and deliver. God, call them out of the cave even now. God, call them out of the cave even now. I pray that better days happen starting today in Jesus' name.